Welcome to Critical Thinking. The subject matter of critical thinking is arguments and explanations, and the skills that we're going to be learning in this class include how to identify, represent, and ultimately and most importantly, how to evaluate both arguments and explanations. We'll begin then with learning how to identify them. Recall from the text that an argument attempts to establish that some claim is true, whereas an explanation tries to establish how it is or why it is that a claim is true. So let's look at some examples. The first example reads, the voting age should be raised to 26 because that's when people's prefrontal cortexes stop developing. The main claim here is that the voting age should be raised to 26. That's not obviously true. It requires evidence to try to establish its truth. And that's what makes this an argument. By contrast, consider this example. Half of the moon appears to be in shadow because that part is facing away from the sun. The main claim of this passage, that half of the moon appears to be in shadow, isn't in question. It's already accepted as true, and what's required is an explanation for why half the moon appears to be in shadow. Now, of course, not all passages are going to contain arguments or explanations. Consider this example. It has been reported that a high-level delegation from the East African nation of Eritrea arrived in Ethiopia to try to broker a truce between the two nations and end a decades-long conflict between them. If successful, the truce would help bolster regional security, end proxy skirmishes between the two countries, and allow Ethiopia access to the sea, which it lost when Eritrea broke away in 1993. There's nothing in this passage that the person writing it is trying to establish as true, nor is there anything in there that the writer is trying to explain. Rather, it's simply an account of what's happening between the two nations. Now, in identifying arguments, indicator words can be your best friends. In section 1.1, you'll find two tables, one containing a list of premise indicators, and the other containing a list of conclusion indicators. I strongly recommend that you study them closely. Think through how they work in the context of passages. You'd be surprised how many students at the end of the semester are still struggling with the basic task of trying to identify premises and conclusions, and learning these indicator words can really help you to avoid that problem. Okay, so once we've identified an argument, the next step is to represent it in some way. And the first method that we're going to learn is how to put an argument in standard form. So again, let's look at an example. The ancient Stoics famously argued that we should not fear death. The reason is that where death is, we are not, and where we are, death is not. Now, not every part of this passage is part of the argument. It begins with the beginning clause, the ancient Stoics famously argued that. Well, that's not part of the argument. That's just telling us who's making the argument. So when we write the argument in standard form, we don't include that phrase. Similarly, indicator words are not parts of arguments, so when we write arguments in standard form, we also don't include those. In this passage, the phrase, the reason is that, is a premise indicator. So once again, that does not get included when writing the argument in standard form. Finally, note that this passage contains a special proposition as indicated by the word and. Remember from section 1.1, there are three types of propositions that commonly appear in arguments: hypothetical propositions, disjunctive propositions, and conjunctive propositions. When you find the first two of these in passages, we never break them up. Conjunctive propositions, however, generally should be broken up. Returning to our example then, the last sentence, where death is, we are not, and where we are, death is not, is a conjunctive proposition, and what appears on both sides of the and express something very different. So this should be broken up with the premises listed separately. Writing the argument in standard form then, we get premise 1, where death is, we are not, premise 2, where we are, death is not, and then the conclusion, we should not fear death. Now, one final thing about writing arguments in standard form. A lot of times we'll have very long propositions that would be really tedious and really not worthwhile to write out entirely. So to avoid that, we can use ellipses. For example, suppose we have a premise that reads, the square of a triangle's hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the square of its sides. With ellipses, we can basically cut out most of that proposition and write the square of dot dot dot, that's the ellipses, and then the end of the proposition, its sides. Now, if you're going to use ellipses, it's important that you include both the beginning and the end of the proposition. A lot of times, students will fall into the mistake of writing the beginning of the proposition, like the square of, and then the ellipses, and then never show me where the proposition ends. You will lose points for doing that. Okay, so in this lecture then, we have talked about what an argument is, what an explanation is, what distinguishes them. We've introduced the skills of how to identify them and how to write arguments in standard form.